Word for you found in the book of Isaiah chapter 41 verse 10 through 11. Isaiah 41 verse 10 through 11. When you have it, say amen. Just to set the stage, there was recently a game that came out. Many of you may know about it. It's a child game. It's called Pokemon Go. And children across the nation and adults are playing this game. They have found themselves going into hazardous situations, hazardous conditions, because they are so influenced by Pokemon Go. Therefore, they walk around the streets searching for Pokemon. They have an addiction to catch them all. I, too, began to explore this game about Pokemon Go. I downloaded it on my phone and began to walk around my neighborhood and play Pokemon Go. But before this, I saw an individual, as I scrolled through Facebook, who expressed that young black children, our children, should not play Pokemon Go because being a black individual in our cultural society today, they might find themselves in danger. They might find themselves in harm's way. But here today, there is a relevant word that speaks exactly to this. Isaiah 41:10 says, "Fear thou not, I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with thy right hand of my righteousness. Behold, all they that were incensed against thee shall be ashamed and confounded. They shall be as nothing, and they that strive with thee shall perish." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks.
This individual said that black children should not play Pokemon Go because they can find themselves in danger. They go about their neighborhoods, they'll be arrested, possibly shot at, possibly in harm's way. But here in Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10 and 11, we find a word. A word that simply says, fear not. So before I get started today, I would like to tell you to speak to your neighbor and tell your neighbor, Don't let anyone stop you from being you. To title this sermon, I would like to title it, Fear Not.
Fear Not.
Here in this chapter of Isaiah, the prophet speaks to us. And he says, do not be afraid, for I am with you. Do not be anxious, for I am your God. I have strengthened you indeed. I have helped you indeed. I have upheld you by my right hand of salvation. See, they are ashamed and confounded, all who are against you. They are as nothing, and they have perished in your adversaries in conflict. Here we see God addressing the nations of Israel. Here in verse 41, the scene is set as a trial of the people. The people have set up a trial against their Lord. They feel as if they are in despair and all hope is gone. You can see and turn back in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 6 and 7. We can see that the people feel as if they are going to die. They feel as if they are rags. I think this is relevant to us today because we too find ourselves in perilous times. We find ourselves in a circumstance and situation that many of us have this thing called fear. We're not certain about what God is doing or where God is at. And here in Isaiah 41, the prophet speaks to this same sort of predicament. The children feel as if God has gone and left them astray. They feel if God is AWOL, away and absent without leave. We can remember in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 6, it says, the voice said, cry. And he said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all the goodliness thereof is as the flowers of the field. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, because the spirit of the Lord will surely the people are grass. Yeah, there's times when we feel like that if God blows upon us that we will lose our breath. We will suffocate in what we know to be life itself. I want you to know that when God breathes upon you,
yes.
God only breathes life.
Hallelujah.
God only brings healing. When God breathes upon you, you have that much more to have in store for you. So we go on and we see that they thought that they would perish. The people of Israel in chapter 40 had expressed that they felt that they were wrath. They felt that if the Lord blew upon them that they would cease. Here in Isaiah chapter 41, the people, the children of God who reside on the islands are called to be a witness in the trial against God. At this time, the people of God need to be persuaded by speeches and words of empowerment and hope and healing. That is what they need. And here in our world today, I think we need that same type of word.
Mm-hmm.
We need a word of empowerment.
Yes.
We need a word of healing. We need a word of hope in times like these.
Amen.
And it says that the children were persuaded by speeches. Mm-hmm. Now we've heard a whole lot of speeches if you turned on your TV here lately.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And these speeches that we oftentimes hear don't seem to persuade me or give me hope or empowerment.
Yes.
But here on today, there's a good news for you. There's a good word for you. There's a bit of hope.
Yes.
There's a bit of empowerment. There's a bit of healing in this word that I have for you today.
Well, all right.
And that word was spoken by prophets of old.
Yeah.
The word simply said, fear not.
Fear not.
Fear not. So today there may be many things that I hear people are fearful of.
Yes.
Maybe you've seen how hate is running rampant down our streets.
Amen.
Maybe you have fear of what the political outcome will be. We don't want Hillary. We don't want Donald Trump. We don't want any of these candidates. So we find ourselves in a predicament of fear. We might be fearful that our job might find itself in a place of unrest. We might feel as if we're about to lose our job in the next coming days. I don't know what fears you. Maybe it's some personal issue. Maybe it's you going back to school. Maybe it's some illness. Maybe it's your very own children. I don't know what causes you fear, but we all find ourselves in predicaments of fear. But here in Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10 and 11, there's a word that says,
fear not.
Maybe you feel the violence that plagues our streets. Our dearest brothers being shot by senseless violence. Maybe you fear the fact that the policemen who are called to protect and serve, find themselves in upheaval. Or if I were to bring it home, some of you may fear that you might have a diagnosis of cancer, progression, or sickness, or illness. But
yes.
Our Bible here provides it with the word that says,
yes.
We can recall a prophet of old who spoke to us years ago, the Dr. Martin Luther King, and he said in his last essay published before his experience with the rain on tail, he said, it is time that we stop our lip service to the guarantees of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. These fine sentiments are embodied in the Declaration of Independence. But that document was always a declaration of intent, rather than a reality. There were slaves when it was written. There were still slaves when it was adopted. And to this day, black Americans have not found life, liberty, nor the pursuit of happiness. And millions of poor white Americans are in economic bondage that is scarcely less oppressive. These words were spoken over 50 plus years ago.
Amen.
But still today, these words ring true.
Amen.
Life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness. These are all things that should be inalienable, freely given to all men.
Mm-hmm.
But we find ourselves in a predicament today in a situation where these rights do not seem to be very free to us.
Amen.
Americans who genuinely treasure our national ideas should welcome the demands of Black Lives Matter. I'll say it again, those who genuinely treasure our national ideas, the ideas of life, the ideas of liberty, the ideas of the pursuit of happiness. To gladly welcome the demands of Black Lives Matter. You might be saying, well, preacher, why should they care about the demands of Black Lives Matter? The shout of Black Lives Matter requires America to re-examine herself, to re-examine the myths that may cause a distraction, a form of drastic reform that will save us from a social catastrophe. What I'm saying is, if we consider what Black Lives Matter means to us in America, it will cause us from a social disarrangement. It will cause for us to find relationship with our brother and sister. It'll cause for us to understand each other a little bit better. But until America accepts that social reform, until they accept that they have caused some myths, they have spoken to us some lies, things will never be the same. So may we speak to this justice and cause for social reform. And Isaiah 41 says, fear not. So my brothers and sisters, I wonder what would happen. We all took to heart what Isaiah 41, 10 and 11 says to us. Isaiah exclaims, fear not. So I ask you today, what would happen if we as a church decided to fear not? Would we be doing church today the same as we do it now? If we decided to fear not, Will we be where we are today?
Well,
if we decided to fear not, would Black Lives Matter be what it is today? What would our world look like if we said, fear not, it all lives matter? Mm-hmm. What would our world look like if we all said, fear not, and spoke out against sex trafficking?
Yes.
If we spoke out against homelessness, if we spoke out against lack of health care, if we spoke out against the ills of big business and the racial tensions that we often see today?
Well,
what would we do if we all said, fear not?
Amen.
I come proclaiming the word that God has placed in the prophet's pen. It now resides in my mouth that says, fear not. Amen. Fear. Yes, fear is an emotional response to an actual threat. Fear is what a fundamental survival mechanism that served us well throughout human history. When you're in immediate danger, fear tells you to get yourself to someplace safe. Fear will tell you to get to someplace safe.
Yeah.
I think this is someplace safe.
Yes.
My Bible tells me that the only place that's safe is the secret place of the Most High. Therefore, I encourage you to find yourself in a secret place. We all need to find that secret place in times like these. We need that secret place. We need to go into our prayer room. Go into your prayer closet. Get inside your secret place. When you reside in your secret place, you'll find joy.
Amen.
You'll find healing. You'll find restoration. But the only safe place is in that sacred space of the Most High. So I'm not certain what your deepest fear may be. Maybe it comes from a skeleton that you have placed deep inside your closet that you want no one to know of. Maybe your fear is of yourself because you know that greatness is inside of you. Or maybe you know that there's a king or queen inside of you. I don't know where your fear may come. But you must assess and discover your fear. We all as individuals must check to see what our own personal fears are. In the midst of fear, one ought to realize the powers they have at their discretion. This scripture reminds us that God is with us. And that God will uphold us with his strength and be assured our Lord has a righteous right hand. And it is mighty in battle.
Amen.
Therefore, all our foes and all those that are against us will perish, for our God is mighty in battle. Fear is an illusion. It is often represented as an acronym as false evidence appearing real. Something we fabricate in our own minds, we pretend it's real. Fear is a fairy tale.
Yes.
We tell ourselves to keep us from doing what we really want to do.
Right.
Yeah, oftentimes fear will keep you from doing what you want to do.
Amen.
So the Bible tells us to fear not. Therefore, God wants you to be able to do what you want to do.
All right.
But fear will keep you from doing those things you want to do it.
All right.
So to overcome fear, the first thing we must seek is God.
Amen.
To overcome fear, the first thing we must do is seek God.
Amen.
And express our fear about the matter at hand. Scripture says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you.
Amen.
Scripture says, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, and love, and of a sound mind. That's what we call to tonight. I want to encourage you today that to really overcome fear, one must look back at their own personal life and think how God has brought you through. And then if you can't recall how God has brought you through, you can look back at your ancestors.
Oh, yeah.
Amen.
And remember how God has brought them to you.
Amen.
Isaiah 41, 10 and 11 says, fear thou not,
yes,
for I am with thee.
Amen.
Be not dismayed, for I am thy God.
Yeah.
Yes. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee.
Hallelujah.
I will uphold thee with thy right hand.
Uh-huh.
Behold, all that were incensed against thee, they shall be ashamed. They shall be nothing, and they shall be cut off and perished.
Amen.
The Bible says in John 14, 16, peace
indeed.
I leave with thee.
Yeah.
Peace, peace I give to
you. Amen.
Not as the world gives.
Yeah.
So do not let your heart be troubled.
Amen.
But lastly, the 23rd Psalm gives me a little hope.
Yes.
It says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. But then the psalmist goes on to say that thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. And that's the news for you today, because when you're in the presence of your enemies, the Lord will make you sit down and look at your women and look them in the eye. And men, when you look your women in the eye, you'll be able to see that they just happy. It's false evidence of hindrance, and they're not able to conquer you, because God has given you strength. He's given you power. He's given you hope. God.
Oh, yes.
Discover him.
Amen.
Make him a power.
Hallelujah.
In your life.
Yes.
Without God, all of our efforts turn to ashes and our sunrise into the darkest night. Without God, life is meaningless. But with God, we are able to rise from the fatigue of despair to the buoyancy of hope. Dr. King said, with God, we are unable to rise from the midnight of desperation to the daybreak of joy. St. Augustine was right. Until we find God and make God a power in our lives, we'll be restless until we find rest in God. So I say to you, love yourself.
Yes.
Love you some you.
Yes.
Don't let fear stop you from being you. Be you. Be who God made you to be. Love your neighbor as yourself, as you are commanded to do that. This is the breath of life. But never forget that there is a greater commandment than this.
Amen.
It is the first and greatest commandment.
Amen.
Love the Lord thy God.
Yes.
With all thy heart.
Yes.
With all thy mind. With all thy spirit. This is the height of life.
Amen.
And when you do this, you will live a complete life.
Yes.
A life of no fear.
No fear.
A life of no worry.
Yes.
A life of no doubt.
Yes.
Love the Lord your God.
Yes.
With all your heart.
Yes.
With all your mind.
Yes.
And with all your spirit. For this is the height of life. Fear not.
Fear not.
Fear not.
Fear not.
For God is with you. And he will. He will uphold you with his right hand. He'll bring you through. He'll bless you.
Amen.
He'll keep you. Lord, thank you for doing it. Abundantly above what you might need.